Welcome to Off the Record News. I'm your host, Diana Longry. Thank you for tuning in. Off the Record News is brought to you live from the SCC studios out of White Bear Lake. And through a cooperative agreement, this program is also simultaneously live to those studios out of the Roseville viewing area, the CTV studios. As a result of this cooperative effort, this program reaches out to and serves approximately 28 communities in the Northeast metropolitan area. And today is February 12, 2014, and as I mentioned, it's live, and I encourage you to call in with any questions or comments or discussion that you would like to have on tonight's topic. Because after all, public access is for the citizens. And that is exactly what we're going to be talking about this evening. Public access under attack again. Now, we on this program of Off the Record News, we have back in January of 2013, we had the first program when this issue of attacking public access came up in the city of Maplewood, where they were first starting to talk about pulling out of the joint powers agreement that they are a part of with other communities that are a part of this studio. And then it looked like things were dying down a little bit, but then again, in March, they had another meeting about the same issue. And so in April of 2013, we had another program here on Off the Record News to show you some film footage where they were talking about pulling out again out of that joint powers agreement of the public access studios here and what their rationale was. However, we were able to also show by looking at some of the documentation from years past that some of those explanations just simply did not ring true. So if you missed those two programs, I've got a couple of little clips to kind of bring you up to speed on this issue so that you can hear with your own ears exactly what was talked about first during those first initial meetings at the beginning and at the end of 2012, rather, and at the beginning of 2013. And then we'll have some film footage of the discussions that were being held in Maplewood in March of 2013. And then we're going to have fresh film footage of the workshop that was just held this February 10th, 2014. We've got a new council, and yet the issue's the same. Public access under attack, number three. So let's take a look at our first clip. Again, this is the early part of 2013 and some film footage also from the end of 2012.
I would like to have the staff bring to us some information in the future, obviously in the early part of next year, where we can weigh the pros and cons of being a member of the cable franchise, because I think that there would be some actual very big advantages to the city to leave the cable franchise. We could probably make more money and do a better job. And so I would ask the staff to gather some information so that we can have a discussion about that next year.
Maplewood is a big dog in that cable commission.
At the cable commission level is that they take out a great deal of money through big fees. And myself and several other people from the other other franchise members feel that we should be doing a better job getting more of that money back to our respective cities. Put this on. They feel we should be doing a better job getting getting that money back to our respective cities when we set the budget.
With her this past fall, late fall, is the issue of unresponsiveness on the part of the Cable Commission to complaints, and some pretty, I'll clean it up, sad excuses for local access programming.
So there you go. Now that, of course, sums up certainly what was going on back at that time frame. But those sentiments, I think, hold true yet today. Now, we will have this opportunity to really delve into the workshop, but I want to then now show some of the clips that we have when they were talking about this issue in March 2013. Because now what we just heard is that they feel that they could do a better job and that they can get more money. And so keep those two themes in mind. Get more money. Let's listen to our first clip. This is with City Manager Antonin, who was the city manager at the time of Maplewood.
On one particular program, and we followed through on that, and that, in my opinion, met with little success from the Cable Commission or perhaps our representative in resolving this matter. The question is simply not so much freedom of speech, but what are community standards for the use of public...
And here's Mr. Antonin talking about the fact that the city of Maplewood filed a complaint that they objected to the content of one of the programs, one time that was on here on Public Access Studios, simply because they didn't like the opinion that was being expressed. And the city manager then talks about whether or not if that's up to community standards, when in reality, as we discussed on a previous program, community standards actually doesn't have to do with whether or not you like the opinion somebody has expressed, and that there's a legal connotation to that. And we had film footage of the Cable Commission's attorney actually discussing that and saying that they could not put limitations on what somebody's opinion is that's being expressed on Public Access TV. So let's listen, though, to our next clip as Mr. Antonin continues on with his formulated excuses for why they need to pull out of the joint powers agreement.
We are poorly served by at least one of these programs in that regard, that I have not been able to determine what the community standards are for this. Therefore, as I mentioned in my memo, there are several examples I see as certainly hate speech that have been perpetrated by some people, certainly in bad taste, if it doesn't meet the threshold of that. So the discussion is basically what the council wants to do about it. I outlined several options. The first would be to do nothing. The second would be for the council to ask the Cable Commission to review and determine what are appropriate community standards to be viewed on the public access channels. And the third is to perhaps consider other sources for the uses of Maplewood, PEG, and franchise fees. I'll be happy to answer any
So now the last final option comes down again to money, because quite frankly, they can't say that somebody can't express their opinion. But if they pull out of that joint powers agreement than the fees that Comcast has paid to them by Comcast subscribers through the PEG fee won't be going to the joint powers agreement anymore and to support all of public access for all of our communities, but instead will go directly to the coffers of Maplewood. So now I have joining with me this evening Mr. Joe Waters. So thank you, Joe, for being here tonight.
Thank you. Pleasure to be here. When I walked in the door and I saw public access under attack part three, I'm going, oh, we must be talking about what happened in Monday night's meeting. I forgot to look at the agenda, but when I saw it after the fact, I thought, oh, here we go again.
Yes, exactly. And I think it's very important to show our viewers some of the past discussions so that when we go through what was being talked about just on Monday, then they'll be able to see it in context so that when they start talking again about the money, you're starting to think, aha, it really is about the money.
Exactly.
And there's a comment that I have queued up here where back in March of 2013 that Mr. Chuck Aull had an idea about what he wanted to do with the money. Now, keep in mind, back then he was the assistant city manager, and he was telling certain council members on the council at that time, and I have this from a good authority, that he was telling them, oh, it's a crazy idea to pull out of the joint powers agreement. That's Antonin's crazy idea. But now that Mr. Aull is city manager, guess whose crazy idea it is now?
It went to Mr. Aull.
That's right. So let's hear what Mr. Aull was thinking about back in 2013, what he would use all this money for. Let's take
a look. We all get very busy, and whether, you know, Michael's taken the lead and done in a few things on, you know, public safety announcements for, you know, where does the sewage go? You know, those types of things, or his 36 project, or Gail did some on the budget. But we need to do much more of that. And so I think Karen has stepped up and volunteered to start leading that, and we need to decide from a staff standpoint, how do we do that? Where do we make that as a priority, and how best do we do it? Do we bump it up and really make it a department head level to have, quote, communications? Well, maybe we do need to add that into a department head level so that you as a council get a feeling that we're telling our story. You know, we're the people of the city hear about things that are going on in the city, not just, you know, watch the council meetings and you find out what's going on. No, there's a lot of other things that go on, and, you know, how many police officers, or, you know, your ideas about rec programs, or, you know, Fish Creek, you know, those types of programs, I think, are the area that we want to go. Your highlighting of it and the retreat just reaffirmed that that's where we need to go. And so I think we're in the process of kind of revamping what we do, and everybody's making it a much higher priority, you know, that, you know, shifting it around. And then, you know, Michael Thompson can talk about public works things. Michael Folds can talk about the IT, you know, Dewey in the parks. Everybody, we need to do that. And I think you'll see a big change 6 months from now over what we've done in the past.
There you go. He wants to have a new department, another department head. In Maplewood, by the way, department heads generally make around $100,000 a year plus benefits. So, you know, you're thinking about, okay, that's kind of how that works. But here's the thing he didn't tell you, is that Maplewood already has their own government channel that they don't utilize fully. So when you heard this, it sounded like, didn't it, Joe, that each one of them wanted to have their own talk show?
That's what it pretty much sounded like
to me. That's right.
Know, they all
want to have their own talk show, and yet, you know, they have their own channel. And they're not using it, and they want to gum up our time and take our talk show time. Imagine that.
Yeah, it's utterly amazing. We've got real serious problems in this city that we need to deal with, and we need to establish a Department of Communications.
Yes.
With a $100,000 a year director. It's like you got enough managers in this place. Why don't you just concentrate on the things that you're supposed to be doing? Just put the video out on the council meetings, you know, and the people can make the decision on their own. We don't need someone interpreting it for us.
Exactly. That's taking away from what we do.
Exactly. That's competition. And we're not getting paid to do this.
No, that's right. We're all volunteers, and none of us here make $100,000. I can assure you of that. Mm-hmm. Now, I understand we have a caller on the line. Caller, thank you for joining us tonight. Comments?
Well, Diane, I want to thank you for addressing the system. Out in the city of Grant, I just looked up a resolution in 2003 that the city of Grant resolution 2003 resolution for supporting the application by the city of Grant to the Ramsey County Cable Commission for equipment installation operator labor for the purpose of recording and cable casting city meetings. Then we have a resolution 2005 resolution adopting a policy for handling the city's recorded media. So it's part of their policy, and yet Mayor Carr refuses to allow the Charter Commission meetings to be taped. He has put all kinds of roadblocks in there, and I think recently their cable commissioner, council member Jeff Huber, came to the cable commission and says he doesn't think city council meetings should be rebroadcast.
Oh.
And yet they have a resolution, you know, to direct that. Maybe you can address that. And I want to say, I want to thank the Suburban Cable Commission mm-hmm. for putting it out there. They are the only honest recording broadcast means we have out there. They're not slanting the story. They're simply taking the minutes and rebroadcasting them.
Well, thank you, caller, for bringing that up, because, you know, this idea that somehow or other that the citizens shouldn't have public access TV is, quite frankly, it's wrong. I mean, it's based in federal legislation, and it, you know, I don't know the whole history of it all, but it's been around a long time, and there's a reason for it, so that citizens have a way that they too can broadcast their points of view when all the big corporations, all the government, everybody that has all the pull, you know, they could get their message out any way they want because they've got the money. Mm-hmm. Folks like us who are citizens, this is our avenue. This is the avenue. And it plays a very important part for many nonprofits and many organizations that, quite frankly, don't have the advertising budget to be able to talk to people in the community about what they do. And this idea that, again, that the city council meetings shouldn't be televised, I mean, that's like going back to the dark ages.
Well, I do know a city in the West Metro about 15 so years ago. I know an individual worked for this city, and their policy was we're not going to televise the council meetings. You want to see the council meeting, you show up. They felt that, you know, the citizens shouldn't be sitting back in their living room watching what's going on and criticizing and, you know, commenting and so forth. Well, to make a long story short, that view didn't hold very long because they're like everyone else. They have, I mean, their meetings are now televised. A lot of their meetings are televised. Their commissions are televised and so forth. Just simply because your neighbor is doing it, you better be doing it yourself.
Absolutely. And with the emphasis today on having greater transparency and more accountability, even though perhaps it's just lip service to those words, you can't totally cut it off, because then your lip service, even that seems very
right.
Hollow.
Right, and generally your corporate media, if you will, they'll only cover an issue if it can be considered controversial. We're converting a golf course into a low-income subsidized housing development. Then the media will show up. But if it's building some sort of high-rise or a hotel, I mean, the people are still up in arms about losing the golf course, yeah, the big media won't show up. So usually your corporate media will only show up if there's some sort of controversy involved. You know, it's like selling sex and puppies and little children. You know, they'll show up. But if you don't have those elements in there, they're not going to show up.
Yep, that's very true. Now, let's get started with our film footage from the workshop, the Maplewood City Council workshop of February 10th, 2014. Now, keep in mind, we saw film footage of Marv Copen, who still remains on the council, so you know where he stands, although I think during the workshop he didn't say one word. Also on the council is Bob Cardinal, who is still there on the council. He did speak a little bit during the workshop. We have Kathy Juneman. She is still on the council. You know where she stands when it comes to public access TV. You heard her comments. And she doesn't like public access TV very much because public access TV is what exposed the fact that she was giving the bird to citizens in the council chambers.
Isn't this the same person that used public access to get elected?
She did.
Just wondering.
Yep, she did indeed. So it served her needs to get elected when she first was running. She was on TV, public access TV, and that was part of her campaign. And now, of course, she wants to shut it down. And then we've got a new mayor, and then we've got another new city council person. And so we don't know where all this is going to shake out. But this new council has taken our long-term cable commissioner, Kim Facile. They did not reappoint her to her position that she had held probably, I think, 12 years.
I think it goes back to about 2000. Yeah, about 2000. Yeah. I'm saying 2006.
Yeah. Well, she was appointed actually during the Bob Cardinal administration.
Okay, that would be prior to 2005. That'd be prior to 2006.
Yep, and so I think she was a cable commissioner for at least 12 years, and by all accounts, I think was doing a fine job, a very steadfast supporter of the First Amendment right. Did a lot of work on the various committees we have here, and really did a great job. There was no explanation at the Maplewood City Council meeting as to why they decided that they needed to appoint a brand new council person who was just even new to being a council person to being our cable commissioner. So we'll have to see what's that about.
I have a feeling, and I have my own gut feeling into what it's all about. It's all about a power grab and being part of the clique. Mm-hmm. I'm assuming in talking with Kim Facile that she was not part of the clique, because I do know at talking with her, I got the sense that she was not happy with the direction that former city manager Antonin was going, because just to the conversation I had with her, I got the fact that Antonin was doing this on his own. He didn't even go through Kim Facile.
And of course, at that time, Mr. Chuckall was pretending to be distant from Mr. Antonin, but now, of course, is taking it on as something to look into. But he has now changed again the reason why they're going to do this, because every time they attempt this attack on public access and pulling out of the Joint Powers Agreement, they find that the last reason that they gave didn't quite work. It wasn't quite honed enough. So now we're going to try to come up with a little different reason and try to perfect it and spin it a little bit differently and see if this time it takes.
So the linguine's not sticking to the wall, so we'll try spaghetti.
That's right. You got it. So let's get started, and we're going to be cutting in and out of here a lot because there's a lot of things we got to get clarified.
I think there'll be more. Next is the discussion of the Ramsey Washington Suburban Cable Commission, which I believe staff is going to lead.
Mayor and Council, thank you. We put this item on the agenda tonight, not with a lot of information, but just something to make sure you as a council are understanding of kind of direction, and we want to be sure that we're touching base with you where we're going. If I might take a step back and just kind of explain kind of the thought process that we as staff are looking at and what we want you to consider in looking at our city being part of the cable commission. Each one of you members have talked about some concerns and issues. From the standpoint of us as staff, and I've asked Karen and Michael and Melinda to kind of work together on this, and so the four of us are actually over the next year going to kind of look at this, and this is not unique to the Cable Commission. It's something I'm challenging every department head to do, and that is to look at something from an efficiency standpoint. And so is it efficient? And so So let me throw a couple numbers out, and I'm going to quote numbers. These aren't, you know, absolute dollars, but just something that actually Michael Folds talked about. And I'm not sure that you as council members are aware of this, but our cable commission from Maplewood gets about $300,000 from Comcast because they use the city right-of-way. So it's a right-of-way fee. Michael Thompson.
He's now talking about some of the dollars. Now, first of all, I want to really clarify here, because there are times within the workshop when they're talking about this money as Maplewood's money, that Maplewood pays this money, that it belongs to Maplewood, when in reality, what it is it's talking about the right-of-way. Comcast has to pay a certain amount of money for right-of-way, and through a lot of other different legislation as well, Comcast, there's this PEG fee, which helps to fund the various different public access channels that you have available to you, one being the Citizens Channel, which is the channel you're watching right now, but also the Government Channel, also the Religious Channel, the Education Channel, and then there's the other couple of channels that has like programming from NASA and other different programming as well. And Maplewood looks at this as if it is their money, when reality, this is actually the people's money, because it didn't come from the Maplewood tax base at all. And later on, as we move forward, you will hear how they will say, well, because only, 49% of the people actually watch cable access TV, well, we should just pull out of it because that's not very efficient. And I would say, when you start listening to them talking about this, think about some of the other services that Maplewood provides that even fewer people utilize, and yet still Maplewood thinks it's a worthwhile endeavor to continue with. Let's say, for instance, the community center. Joe, do you think 49% of the people who live in Maplewood get to use the Maplewood Community Center?
Oh, wishful thinking at that. Wishful thinking at that.
Yes. And so that's one thing I want folks to think about. And then you'll also hear the statement somewhere along the way here where they will say, well, people aren't watching because they don't have the ability to. But that's not true either, because our franchise agreement in this area, that if you're not a subscriber to Comcast, you still can get your public access channels for free. And so if somebody hasn't chosen to sign up for something free, that's their own decision.
Yep.
But it is available to everybody, 100%, unless you live in some of the senior high rises, which unfortunately we're not properly wired to allow for it, which is an unfortunate thing. But for the most part, anybody who is in a single-family house can have public access channels at no cost. Now, you cannot get that with the community center.
Exactly. would think that, because that's tax-subsidized. You'd think all you would do is walk in with your driver's license and show that you live in Maplewood, meet one of the zip codes, you should get a free membership.
Right. Well, you can this week get one free week.
Oh.
Oh, yes. Okay.
Out of what, 52?
Yeah, out of 52. That's right. Okay, so let's continue on.
Various users in the city. So if some private company comes in and wants to cut a hole and use the street, they charge them a fee. Well, similarly, we do that with Comcast because they go citywide. And so that's $300,000 that come to the citizens of Maplewood. And we as a city, simply because it's what we did last year and the year before, we simply turn that $300,000 over to Ramsey Washington Suburban Cable Commission to use as the...
Now- Now, that's not all entirely true either, I don't think, because a portion of it does go to help fund the studios, which, of course, Maplewood does get some of that back because they've got their government channel, and there are paid staff here who will help Maplewood put together all the productions and talk shows they want for their channel. But Maplewood doesn't utilize that, you see. And then at the end of the year, there's a final accounting of all the money between all the cities and what was the overhead here at the public access suburban community channels. And then if there's money left over, guess what? It doesn't go into a big kitty as somebody's big profit that they're holding off to the side somewhere. It actually is distributed back out to all of those member cities within that joint powers agreement. And typically in the past, Maplewood has gotten somewhere around, like $140,000 to $150,000 a year, which then they put into the operational budget, and they just go spend it on something.
So essentially they're getting half their money back.
That's their money. That's right.
You got me thinking that way too, because I'm sitting there thinking, wait a minute, I just paid my Comcast bill for the month, mm-hmm. and I noticed a $4 discrepancy between the last bill and the current bill. So I started digging into it, and of course, programming costs have gone up, so that was $3 of the $4. But when I looked at the franchise fee, that went up from $4.29 to $4.50, I believe.
Oh.
And it basically said it's because of your local government requirements that force this fee to go up. Now, I pay that money to Comcast.
Yes, you do.
So is Comcast now paying that money to the city?
They...
You had a blank look like, I'm not so sure. That's the real question that I have.
Yeah.
If I'm paying it to Comcast paying it to the cities for the franchise fee, which I can understand, mm-hmm. that portion of it. So it's really not Comcast money, it's our money.
Yes, that's exactly right. And you will hear during the workshop that they kind of intermingle some of the principles of the joint powers agreement and being a part of that joint powers agreement with other communities, with other municipalities in the community. And then they sometimes mix that with the principles of this franchise agreement. And it's hard to know which is which because they don't really have that in-depth of a discussion.
Mm-hmm.
And it's, I think, made confusing not only for the council, but for the citizens at home as well. So now I understand that we have a caller on the line. Quick question. Okay. Well, anyway, sorry about that.
Yeah, that's okay. I'm here.
Oh, okay, good. Oh. Okay, go ahead.
Caller, one of the things that they're to do is cloud transparency. They don't want the residents to see what government is doing. By having cable access, we provide snippets of what's going on. For example, in the city of Grant, who wants to sit through a three-hour boring meeting? However, if we give snippets of the main parts of action that happen, it keeps citizens aware of what's happening. They can see what's going on. They don't go to sleep. And that's one thing that's very important. And they're trying to cloud transparency. Now, in Maplewood, there's been many things happening with the taxes, the assessments, the garbage disposal, the things they're trying to do. And they're saying that this is what the citizens want. But basically, they're clouding transparency so citizens can't really see what's going on. And if you could respond to that, I'll hang up and listen.
Well, caller, I think you're pretty much spot on there, because that appears to me to be actually the underlying reason. They're not going to actually come out and say that's the reason. However, there are comments from time to time throughout the meetings where you will hear these underlying comments about, those people on public access TV. Well, I think that, you know, those people on public access TV is actually you and me. Joe, that's you and I.
Correct.
Correct. That's who it is.
But it tells you what they're also watching, too.
Yes, that's true. Because they wouldn't be so concerned about our content if they weren't actually watching. So thank you very much for watching. I hope you enjoy this evening's show. Anyway, so let's continue on with our film footage.
See fit. Okay, so in addition, there's, you know, the public education government, PEG, the PEG. And that's something that, as part of a franchise, anybody that has Comcast pays a fee, and that, believe it or not, generates about $300,000 as well. So that's fine. Yeah, we'll keep going. And so they're taking that money, and again, that's money that is given to the Cable Commission to create public education and government access for us. And so, in effect, they get $600,000 a year from Maplewood. Now, rather than discuss how that PEG money, the PEG money, is used, which really sometimes, you know, we agree with or we disagree. I mean, we use it. And one of the things that, as you know, Karen is working on is trying to really enhance what we do. My focus is more on that right-of-way and the that right-of-way money, because it's money that's paid to Maplewood for using our right-of-way. But when you talk about efficiency and from a dollar standpoint, the numbers that I see are only 47% of our residents have Comcast cable and get the service. All right, even though 100% of our residents own the right-of-way. And so in my mind, that's not an efficiency way to deliver service to our residents.
Now, if we're going to be talking about right-of-way, let's talk about landline telephones.
Okay.
Okay. It used to be almost 100% of the homes had landline telephones.
That's correct.
But now many homes no longer have a landline telephone.
It's upwards of 50%.
There you go. But you know what? The telephone company still needs that right of way to be able to serve the 50% who want to buy the landline service. So is Maplewood going to say, we're going to discontinue your right-of-way because only 50% of our citizens don't buy a landline telephone anymore?
Under that logic, yes.
Under that logic, yes. Now, there you go. Does that make sense to you? Okay, let's continue on.
Expressing concerns about some program that somebody may have really liked or didn't like, or how we, you know, broadcast our government issues. My focus for you and the direction that I'm suggesting we as a council go is to kind of look at, you know, are there better ways to deal with some of this and be more efficient in how we do that and enhance, you know, Karen Guilfoyle's efforts to tell our story. You know, if, you know, it's great to tell our story.
Yes, let's tell our story. You know what? We could do that if we got a new department and a new department head. Now, remember how that goes back to March 2013 when this was the big idea? Well, you know what? The big idea is still there. Oh, my goodness. Okay, let's continue on.
Put great stories together. They're only getting to 47% of our residents. Whoops, that's not efficient. If you know, I guess if I was a baseball player and I was batting for, you know, hitting 47%, yeah, I'd be good. But that's not our goal. Our goal is to be in the 90%. You know, people, you know, we can't make them watch, but at least they'll have it available. Only 47% have that available. And so the plan and what I want for you as a council to talk about tonight is, are you comfortable with us exploring? I don't know where that's going to go. I mean,
So here we've got the premise now. okay, since only 40%, okay, now suddenly now the percentage has become 40% when earlier I think it was 47%. But let's just round down for efficiency.
Well, let's split the difference, okay? Let's just call it 43.5%.
Or maybe 20.
Why not?
Why not? Whatever. But here's the thing is that if you know that there's 40% of the people who are watching on public access TV, you know, that city of Maplewood could come here, use their government resources, and they have actually a special studio next to ours, which actually the volunteers here never get to use. They have a really nice studio right next to us that we get to just look in the window kind of. And
we'll just kind of peek around and go, oh, wow, yeah.
Yeah, wow, yeah. So anyway, but they could be making their little vignettes during their 9-to-5 job and then put those on YouTube to reach the other 60%. They could be doing that.
I know a number of cities, even in the metro area, that do just that.
And they could do that right now without even talking about pulling out of the joint powers agreement or changing the right of way or whatever. They want to become creative. All they would need to do is actually come and speak to all the volunteers here who have already discovered all these things, and we do all those things. Imagine that.
That would entail talking to us,
yes,
which they don't want to do. We don't want to talk to those people.
Those people, that's right. So let's continue on and find out what else is in our future.
But we as staff are going to look at those options, and Council Member Abrams is on the board. She's, you know, you've appointed her on there, and we very much support that and have for years. The staff actually suggested that having a council member on there would be good, not to disparage Kim Facile. She did a wonderful job for us, but having that interaction, and so I believe that 2014.
So now there we go. There's the pushback. You see, it's actually the staff and the administration who did not want to have our cable commissioner to be a citizen like the volunteers here. You know, Kim Facile originally started out as a volunteer putting on programs. That's where her passion for public access and what we all do here came from. Because she was a person who was using the studio resources here. And she was appointed as a citizen. And now we find out where that pushback was really coming from.
Well, I have a theory on that. I think one of the reasons why you have pushback from staff is because staff can't go up to Kim and say, now remember, this is how you got that position. Mm-hmm. But on the other hand, given the way this past election ran and the people made their decision, I've said that before, staff can go up and say, well, you seem to have forgotten how you got here.
Yes.
So that's just a theory. Just call it a crazy theory. But I got a feeling that's how it's come about.
Yeah. Now, I understand that we have a caller online. Caller, thank you for calling comments this evening.
Mayor Longry and Joe Waters, and I remember while you were Mayor of Maplewood, Ms. Longry, you were always very supportive of the Cable Commission and of public access, and you were in the forefront advocating that the benefit in a democracy, how important it is to have the freedom of expression and of speech, which public access gives the opportunity for people to enjoy, so that the only choices that people have to listen to at home aren't just Fox TV or CNN, or all the talking heads trying to push their political ideology, that people actually become more well-informed of what's going on in their community. And I congratulate you on that, and it's very disingenuous and shameful to see these elected officials and these public officials taking steps to try to frustrate people to participate in their community.
Yeah, thank you very much, caller, for those comments. And I do believe that public access TV is important for citizens to, one, know what is going on in their community, to being able to have an opportunity to communicate their viewpoints or what they're doing to other members of their community, and three, to do exactly what we do here at this program, have an opportunity for folks who are out there watching to participate in what's going on here at the studio. Now we have some more film footage from the February 10th workshop. So let's take a quick look.
For us to kind of understand and get a better understanding, because, you know, if Chief Schnell needs a police officer, gee, maybe we shouldn't be spending all that $300,000 in the cable money over there. Maybe we can get one more police officer and spend only $200,000 or whatever it is. And so those are that's how I think we want to frame that discussion and frame it from that standpoint. And so I asked our staff to put this on the agenda and just say, okay, let's throw the issue out there and make sure the council's on board with us and understand that we're...
So now we have now the second argument. So first, the first argument is that's not the efficient use of our right of ways. And then number two, maybe then we could use actually that money for something different. We could use it to hire more police officers, except that keep in mind, they haven't yet talked about the issue that this right-of-way or that the federal legislation having to do with how it controls companies such as Comcast and allowing to have a certain amount of airwaves available for citizens, how that's impacted by this whole idea that, well, we'll just take that money that really is supposed to be for something else, we'll just move it on over and go and buy a police officer instead.
Well, that was kind of my question. Isn't the PEG fee a dedicated fee for getting information about the public, whatever it stands for, public education and government? Isn't that fee used for getting information out about government?
Well, that's my understanding. And then if all the money isn't used for that, well, then it's distributed out to the member communities. And then one of the things I always wanted to do when I was mayor is to actually say that money would remain dedicated once it came back to Maplewood, that it would be used for communicating with citizens.
Well, that's kind of the direction I was going to go, because mm-hmm. I do remember you saying that when you held Citizens Forum, you wanted the money used to improve communications. One of the things that you wanted to be used for is to improve the monthly news magazine that goes out and so forth, to improve the internet or the web page so citizens can get more interactive information, not to be used for a police officer. Not to say a police officer is bad, but that should come out of general fund monies rather than dedicated money. So it's kind of sound like he took a page out of the 2011-2012 legislature's book when Republicans ran the Minnesota House and Minnesota Senate. We'll steal from this fund and throw it in the general fund and say, we never raised taxes to do this.
There you go. Now, I understand we have another caller on the line. Caller, thank you for calling in. Questions or comments?
Yes, I've been listening to this program. And, you know, if this is the citizens' money that we're paying in with this PEG fee, why couldn't we go after them with a court battle and have a good lawyer like yourself get that money back and keep that cable commission going?
You know, that's a very good question, because in the end, I do think that there is federal legislation that comes into play here. I do not understand it all or know exactly everything that it entails, but I do know that they can't just say, well, we're going to just take the money from the PEG fee and decide that we're going to use it for police officers. I really don't think that they can do that. But I could be wrong, because maybe what if the legislation was changed in the last couple years and it was modified somehow and citizens aren't protected and none of us know that?
That could very well be the case.
I don't know.
The caller has a very good idea. I was hesitant to say that, but the caller makes up a very good point, because as I'm sitting here listening to him, it could be an administrative law judge you go in front of him saying, hey, you know, in front of some like the FCC saying, this money's dedicated for this purpose, it's being used for something totally different. I do know there have been cities that have gotten grants for specific projects where the money went elsewhere, and there were court battles and the city's lost because the money, say, is dedicated for hiring parks workers, but it was used to hire new accountants in finance. It's like, nope, that money was hired. You got that grant to hire parks workers. That's where that money's going to go. So the caller brings up a very good point. But like you said, you need someone that's well-versed in communication law and probably federal legislation of some sort.
Yeah, that's exactly it. And I know that our SCC here, that they have their attorney that is very knowledgeable in this area and in the franchise agreement and how to negotiate that, and has been with them as their attorney for a very long time.
I see this as kind of a widespread. If say this suit were to go through, you'd almost want to bring Comcast in versus bringing in the attorney for the cable commission.
That's right.
Because there's, not to say there's a potential conflict, but there might be some. What's the word I want to use? Well, maybe it would be some potential conflict.
But he might be a resource to know whether or not
there
would be some basis to be able to say that they're misappropriating the funds.
Correct.
So let's take a look at our next part of our clip here and see where it takes us.
You know what? That's a good investment. It's very efficient. It works good. And here's what we're going to do, and here's a plan. But I don't know where it's going to go, but that's the direction I'd like to. And so I'll...
We have some questions. Council Member Cardinal.
Thank you, Mayor. That 47% might be down a little bit in the last couple year, 5-10 years. I know it was up 52 or better. So Comcast does not like to get that information out. I'll tell you that. You really got to dig and scratch for that. So, and Michael, you know that, don't you? So
so now Bob Cardinal, he is not a stranger to Public Access TV. You know, for years and years he had his cable access TV program, One and the Same, where he hosted it. So he's, you know, so he's not a stranger to Public Access TV. And sometimes it sounds like he is a supporter of keeping Public Access TV and keeping Maplewood in the Joint Powers Agreement. And then other times you kind of wonder, maybe he's on the fence. It's always hard to know which position he's really supporting. And I don't know exactly why that is, but I like it when politicians tell you straight out where they stand. Now, while we're chatting here a little bit more, if you could move our video a little bit further ahead, and so we can hear Ms. Abrams, who is the new cable commissioner, and some of her thoughts. So, and also, when we get to the end of our meeting, Joe, I have actually a clip where it turns out that just only this past weekend, Nora Slawick was on a program here in the studios talking about becoming mayor. And she's using Public Access TV studios, and certainly she expresses an opinion during her interview, which I thought was very fascinating. And so while I certainly support her right to have an opinion and express her viewpoint, I would hope that she would also support my right to express my opinion and have a viewpoint as well.
So would I.
So we'll. I want to tease you, our viewers, with that a little bit there, so that way they'll want to hold on to the end of the show. So let's take a look at our next clip. Okay, they're getting it ready. So one of the fascinating things that I again, is that the reason I'm hoping that we'll have this clip of Ms. Abrams is that she talks about, well, she would hope that Comcast can give this information, and as the commissioner, that is what she's going to do. She is going to go and get that information. She actually made a commitment about what she's going to do as a commissioner.
Interesting.
So I hope she can do it.
So do I.
Okay, so let's take a look. Well, let's just see where we're at. Okay, let her run.
And then there's this partnership we're in, right? Which do we have to stay in that partnership, or can we? Is that another thing we can do? Is change that?
Mayor, My understanding, I think we could cancel it with 30 days' notice. I mean, we've had Mr. Cantridge start looking at that, and that's something that, you know, it may not be something we want to do, but it's going to be one of the options that we will explore and say, you know, we simply can do it our own. There's, I think, St. Louis Park and Blaine do their own thing. Burnsville does their own thing. However, that means, holy cow, we're going to have to staff up to do that, too. And so we're going to have to deliver service. And so it may not be a great solution, but one that we can do. And so we need to look at all of that. And so that'll be, you know, our 10, 12, 14-month study, whatever we do. But I think 30 days is answering your question. We can cancel in 30 days.
And you can, there's also other partnerships we could join.
Yes.
Yeah. So it may be option nine. Councilmember Juneman?
I think we should.
Okay, so I would like to know what other kind of partnerships could they join other than, I would like to know what other partnership can they join besides the joint powers agreement that we're already in? Would they be joining the joint powers agreement with SPNN in St. Paul?
You might even be going to Twin Cities Public Television.
I don't know.
And get on the Minnesota channel. I mean, that's... that's how the legislature is covered.
Right. You know, but, so, but what I find fascinating is that Mr. All assures her, oh, yes, with 30 days' notice, we can get out any time, except that we, of course, have talked about that agreement here on this program to say that that if they do pull out, that they actually have to stay in until the end of the year. So even if they do pull out any time this year, they have to stay till the end of this year. So it isn't really a 30-day pullout. Now, we are down to the last of our program. Let's play our clip now of Ms. Nora Slawick on Public Access TV.
And so he was kind of looking around for somebody, and I had a couple people approach me and said, you know, why don't you run? Because frankly, we needed to win. Mm-hmm. Maplewood has had a very, you know, rocky, checkered past, mm-hmm. and they're, so that was during a period of time, and then Will came and kind of really turned things around, and then the person was running again. And so it was very important we had someone that could win. Yeah. And so since I've won 7 elections, had some name recognition, like both of you.
So anyway, Will Rossbach turned it around, and as if he wasn't part of the dysfunction. So with that, we're got one last clip that we're going to end with, so that folks can remember about the Rossbach administration, and they can decide whether or not he turned it around.
And you are done. So sit down. Your microphone's off. None of that that you're saying is being picked up. And so sit down. Sit down. Sit down.
Yeah, you are arrogant and rude.
Yes, I am. Thank you.
Style. Inside, outside, Willie sends them silly with a star shine.